At Toyota, the engineer who did most to push the pace was Taiichi Ono.
例えば機械が自動で削っておる。
Machines actually work by themselves. So someone standing over one, watching it intently, might think he's working. But the machine's doing fine on its own. So I'd say that's a waste of manpower.
無駄なんだよと。で、このまあ無駄を見つけて、まあ非常にこう上手に見つけるのが当時おりましてね。
If I found a job that was being done efficiently, I would say, try doing it with half the number of men. And after a time, when they had come back and said that they'd done that, I'd say, okay, half the number again.
At night, I'd have dreams. My job was the last one on the line, and I'd dream that I wasn't keeping up. And just as the engine was about to fall off the end, I'd wake up with a shout. Things got to that stage.
If I just called the foreman and said, stop the waste, people wouldn't understand what I meant. They'd say, but we've always done things that way. Or, this man's a hard worker. But I'd say, you can't see straight. That's not real work. So unless I spoke to the worker right on the shop floor, it was difficult to get things to change.
With the introduction of the production line, the foreman's job changed. His role now was to see that the line ran smoothly. Before that, they'd felt that wasn't enough. That if they weren't getting their hands dirty, they weren't really working. But Mr. Ono would come along and say, your job is to stand here and make absolutely sure that the line is moving properly. I remember him drawing a chalk circle on the floor and saying, you stand in here.
Ono was the most creative engineer in the post-war car industry. He made the maximum use of human labor, and he changed the whole system which fed the assembly line itself. In the traditional method, the many different parts, doors or engines, had been pushed out in big numbers and piled up beside the line until they were needed. This was Henry Ford's method.
Yeah, so we did that,
If we'd done that in post-war Japan, especially in the motor industry, we would have gone bust straight away. Goods needed to be turned into money as quickly as possible. So we really had to keep our stocks to the bare minimum.
Ono saw that by carrying 1 or 2 months' stock, Toyota was tying up immense amounts of capital. So the company reorganized the factories until the assembly line and the making of the parts ran at the same rate. Parts were only made and called to the assembly line in the quantity needed. The Japanese called it the just-in-time method.
With the just-in-time system, the most important thing was to produce only what was needed. When workers needed more parts, they themselves would go and get them. But if they took parts away without leaving anything in exchange, you would have a problem. So just as in a supermarket, where customers take goods from the shelves and exchange them for money, we used what we call a Kanban instead of money. At each workstation, the Kanban acted as a sort of order form. The Kanban said, in effect, this number of these parts has been used, so please make this number of the same parts and place them here.
The Americans used their huge presses to stamp out the same parts for weeks at a time. The Japanese made fewer vehicles, but a range of models, so they had to use the same presses to make parts for different cars.
I wanted the machines to produce sets of 100 of one shape, and then change to another. Although the production may have only taken minutes, changing the machines could take hours, and everyone would be standing around doing nothing, wasting time.
Ono got the time for changing the dies in the presses, which took up to 3 hours in America, down to a few minutes. Then the same machine that had just been pressing mud guards could get on with other parts. The Ono revolution to get the best use of labor and machines was extended to all the suppliers. Productivity increased fourfold in 10 years.